Now, I would normally introduce the person on stage with me, but of course, Peter Fincham has been doing so many sessions. You'd actually have had to be on Mars for the last 2 days not to have encountered him. And this is Meet the Controller. He is apparently waiting to get root canal treatment, so clearly he can put up with a lot of pain. So this session should be a bit of a dodo, really. 10th controller session. Lord, you not get a medal or something for that? Unbelievable. Well, actually, I thought perhaps we could have done it at your house. Because clearly, there's a lot of people in this session. In fact, it's full, but you've got such a big fuck-off house. You could get it done in your house. And we could have got to play guitar. And we could have seen what was in your fridge. Anyway, welcome to this session. The people have already been sending in questions, but we can take them from the floor as well. And before we begin properly, 60th anniversary of ITV, what would you like to receive as a birthday gift?
Oh, God.
Another house.
Are you really going to ask silly ass questions like this?
Yes.
No, you don't do
actually,
this on news night.
I think it's much more, it's much more likely that you could be altruistic and give some of your audience members.
Let me think. I think the best 60th birthday present for ITV, I'm afraid, this isn't going to be a very good answer because they've already had it, and it would be a purpose-built, state-of-the-art set for Coronation Street to ensure another 60 wonderful years of Coronation Street. As a matter of fact, that's exactly what we just built in the last year or so. But and I don't say that trivially because it's a kind of instructive thing here because we're all involved in the creation of television programmes and that's in a way what this whole festival is about and how do we develop more hits and we're so used to it, but imagine that sometime in 1959. There may have been a meeting about a list of program ideas that somebody was trying to sell to the guy who ran Granada at the time. And somewhere down on that list, it might have been number 7 or number 8, might have been this idea by this unknown writer called Tony Warren to do a kind of working class drama set among the Manchester area. And you might have thought, well, what are the chances of getting it commissioned? Quite slight. Might it get to a second series? Well, you never know, but it probably won't. Imagine if you could have projected forward and said, in well over now 55 years' time, that will still be a cornerstone of the ITV schedule. And indeed, will have occupied this, for anybody who's been there, up at Salford Quays, this incredible set. It's an extraordinary thing, an extraordinary story. And in a way, anything that any of us might be talking about today, that could happen again. But television is, without getting all sentimental about it, television is still a land of opportunity.
But can it happen again when you've got still Coronation Street going, taking up a lot of money, delivering you huge audiences? You go, well, why take a creative risk when Coronation Street's delivering us this audience?
Well, I don't know. It's a good question. Maybe not that, but maybe something of its ilk. Television programs don't have a preset life. They can, they can last a very long time, and they can become part of what you accept and what's part of, if you like, the television landscape. But I can't think of a more remarkable example than Coronation Street, which goes back to literally the 1950s, before many of the people in this room were born.
Well, let's turn to your first of your clips, the one you cited as channel-defining, Saturday Night Takeaway. This is the programme that you think defines the channel. Why?
Well, I wanted to... I mean, there's many programmes you could have chosen to define the channel, Coronation Street being another one, but I wanted to choose one. The Edinburgh Festival, by its nature, is this quite sort of upmarket thing, and we talk a lot about drama and factual and so on. And so I thought I wanted to choose a programme that was absolutely straight down the line family entertainment. And I can't think of a better example than Antidex Saturday Night Takeaway. They rested the show for a few years, which is a risky thing to do with a show. It didn't quite end, and it was a gap, I think, for about 3 or 4 years, and then came back.
But really. That doesn't really fit in with your own challenge that you set yourself last year. In fact, you were actually saying that you thought you'd played it safe in terms of programming. So how risk-taking is it to bring back a programme that you've rested.
Hang on, you've got different categories here, and you're about to come to biggest risk taker of the year. This one wasn't supposed to be that. This one was supposed to be channel defining programme of the year. So I chose Antidex Saturday Night Takeaway.
I mean, yes, I know, but that sort of essentially means that your channel defining programmes are not necessarily particularly risk taking.
Oh, no, it doesn't mean that at all, Cassie. Why, risk is a word we all use and we will use in this session, and absolutely rightly so. But there's nothing to be embarrassed about the fact that one of the channel defining programs, as I said, there's quite a lot of channel defining programs on ITV, but there's nothing to be embarrassed about the fact that one of them is Antidex Saturday Night Takeaway. I chose it precisely to get away from, if you like, the and I'm not aiming this at you, there's a sort of snobbery that goes around the word risk as if the riskier the better in commissioning. Now, commissioning is absolutely about taking risks, but I absolutely assure you, viewers don't sit there on a Saturday night thinking, has the controller taken a risk? They're not giving us brownie points for risk. They're watching the television thinking, is this entertaining? And Antidex Saturday Night Takeaway is an entertaining programme.
Yes, but you are in front of an audience of people who probably want to pitch programmes to you. And when you have those kind of programmes, they think perhaps
that
you're not interested.
That is why, when you come to ask the question about which was the riskiest commission we did this year,
I will
talk specifically about a programme that we'll be taking a risk on.
But I might not ask that.
Okay. We've had different briefing notes.
Let's look at a programme that's a kind of well-known name programme then that's coming back, except it's not going to be Saturday night, it's going to be Sunday night at the Palladium.
Yeah.
So clearly that's not a risk-taking programme.
Well, of course it is, because if you commission Sunday night at the Palladium, which is a sort of iconic title from many years ago on ITV, hasn't been on for many years, it's a risk because people might say we don't want that back at all. So yes, of course it's a risk. As I say, this word risk, I mean, we talk about it for the rest of the session if you like, but it's one of those words used and overused to the point that requires some definition. I used to, when I was a producer in talkback, you know, for many years, I mainly made programme for BBC Two and Channel Four, and I made what you could clearly identify as very risky programmes like Brass Eye or whatever, and you tick the box saying risk. And so I probably subscribed to, I think, what is the implication of what you're saying, which is that the world of the mainstream isn't a risk-taking world. Having worked in the mainstream for about 10 years now as a channel controller, believe me, commissions in the mainstream are risky commissions. Sunday night at London and Palladium is not a safe bet. You know, so it's a bizarre thing that with mainstream success, the minute you have mainstream success, people assume it never risk in the first place. It's the most common thing that people would ask me about or say about Downton Abbey is to say, well, you must have known all along it was going to be a big hit. As if, well, it was obvious, wasn't it? No, it was a bloody great risk.
You revealed at Edinburgh.
This is, I wasn't intending to come out like this. I thought she was going to get aggressive, not me.
I think it's much more fun when it's the other way around. We can take it. But I'm just asking you that your own audience research, you said yourself that your own audience research you did with your mainstream audience, that watches Anton Deck, that watches Coronation Street, they don't think you're taking, as it were, you're playing it safe in terms of programming. What does that mean? Because you said,
I think that's a perfectly fair challenge. You've been wrongly briefed.
Did you not say that?
No. It wasn't the audience. The audience do not sit there thinking...
Of course they don't sit there thinking,
have they taken risks if they're marking an exam? This was in the survey of producers, which, by the way, that was done again today, but it was done for the first time last year, and on both occasions ITV came out, you know, as the best commissioners by quite a long way. But the one thing that we were slightly weaker on was risk-taking, and I take that, and that's a perfectly fair criticism, but I also think it speaks to that idea that if you like, risk naturally exists in the world of kind of BBC Two or Channel Four, and the mainstream world is not a risk-taking world. Well, come and work in it for a while, and you quickly see that it is a risk-taking world. It's just a different form of risk.
Did you take too much risk when you paid a lot of money for the Rising Star format?
Well, the Rising Star format, that's probably a question to ask in a year's time, but our view of the Rising Star format is that it's in an area of entertainment, of talent shows, it's one that's got a genuinely unique selling point of difference. Its relationship with the audience is new and different and fresh. So I certainly think it's a risk, of course, to take it on, but I thought we were supposed to take risks, so I'm glad we have, and we will find out, you know, in due course whether that was the right, you know, right call.
When do you expect Rising Star to be on television?
It'll be on in the first half of next year. So
when do you start shooting it?
Well, it's a live show, so roughly the moment it goes out.
When do you start preparing it? When do you actually start working? I mean, is it going to go on the telly, is what I'm asking?
It's going to go on the telly, and it'll go on the telly in the first half of next year. And if you could assure me that there was nobody from the BBC, Channel 4, Channel 5 or Sky in the audience, I might give you more details. But
I don't think there is, actually. I'm a Celebrity, 13 and a half million viewers. Is that going to run? Is that the plan?
Well, I'm glad you've asked that, because I want to pay tribute to my predecessors who took the risk on that, because that was a really risky commission, because they cleared the schedule for it and stripped it and gave themselves no hiding place at all. And I would admit, actually, so this is going back to when I was running Talkback and I had that rather kind of, you know, brass-eye skewed view of the world. And I remember reading about it and thinking, that looks like a lazy old idea. I thought it sounded like a kind of amalgam of Survivor and Big Brother, you know, kind of swilled in with celebrities or whatever. Well, I totally underestimated it because I didn't realise how brilliantly it would be made, obviously brilliantly presented by Anton Deck. And it started in the same year as Big Brother on Channel 4, but it's not just going strong. I think I'm right in saying that the last series was the highest rating series ever. So that's it. You know, again, it goes back to that thing about longevity of programmes. Mm-hmm. The fact that that is now 13, 14 years old doesn't matter the viewers in the least. I think the secret of I'm a Celebrity is that I always like to compare it to Wimbledon. It disappears for most of the year and then just comes back for a couple of weeks. So every year, you think you're sort of watching it for the first time. There's never a year goes by where people don't come up to me halfway through I'm a Celebrity and say, Anton Deck are jolly good this year, aren't they? As if they were rubbish last year or the year before. They're always very good, but people rediscover it because they haven't seen it for 49 weeks of the year. So, yeah, it'll be back.
If you look, though, at series that kind of, you talk about that having, you know, when you go back to Rising Star, that it's going to have this unique selling point because of the interaction with the audience, because of the technology and so forth. If you look at a crowded market as well in some other area of entertainment, look at something like Stepping Out. Was it just a bad idea to try yet another dance show?
Well, I think I think that is a fair, you know, it's a fair point. And I think, you know, the danger when you're doing another dance show is that it turns into just another dance show.
Yeah.
But it's a terribly thin line between that and something that, if you like, finds a gap in the market. And I just to use an analogy here, because I was at the BBC at the time, we thought that about Britain's Got Talent when we heard about it. We thought, no, there's too many of these talent shows around. It's not different enough. We were wrong, weren't we? You know, it was different enough to establish itself. And of course, that's, you know, one of our most successful entertainment shows. So, you know, hindsight is a wonderful thing. And I don't want to, a lot of people who worked on Stepping Out, who worked on the very best entertainment shows, I suspect with hindsight it wasn't quite different enough. But again, that's a particular factor of big Saturday night entertainment. You put the same talented producers and development people, directors together, and one day they'll come up with the X Factor, and another day they'll come up with one that doesn't quite make it. It's a terribly thin line between the two.
Funny you should talk about the X Factor, because there is a question here. Are you expecting ratings for the X Factor to rise with the return of Simon Cowell, or are they going to continue to fall?
Well, I don't want to put any, you know, I don't want to put any sort of pressure of expectation at all on it. So I'm delighted that Simon's back in it. It's pretty imminent now. We're really excited about it. I've often pointed this out, and I'm a Celebrity is a good reference point for it. So Strictly Come Dancing on BBC One. If you think, as you might, that the natural curve of a big entertainment show is to go up and then go down, look at the history of them. You're wrong. They can do that and that and that. So, you know, there's a few years, maybe about 5 or 6 years ago, when I'm a Celebrity drifts for a couple of years, then it starts growing again. So X Factor, of course, we're very, very excited about the new series. And we believe it'll be huge and big, but I don't want to put any particular pressure on them.
But here we are with this is your big, big thing about ITV Entertainment is you're looking for new stuff. And so, you know, everybody in here, many people would like to pitch to you. So what are you actually looking for in terms of entertainment?
Well, I think, you can answer that in various different ways. I think that it would be fair to say that the existing big entertainment formats, that the really strong ones, the sort of juggernauts of entertainment, not just on ITV, but across the piece, including BBC One, my personal belief is that their lifespans are long. I mean, I'm not saying they're like Coronation Street, will run 55 years, but people who say, oh, as they said a few years ago, looks like Strictly Come Dancing's on its last legs or whatever, no, they were calling that far too early. That's our job to make sure, you know, that our best shows remain fresh and so on. So they do then take up a lot of space in the schedule, take a lot of budgets, and of course the attention of the audience. The audience still loves them. We would, of course, as well as those, like more big juggernauts that are, you know, genre, era-defining entertainment. But I would say if you lined up all the genres of television and all the slots and all the opportunities, I'd say this to people who work in the development area, that's the toughest of all. That really is the toughest of all. And no shortage of people work all the time on this. You know, production companies who are extremely well-resourced with big development teams because they realise the huge international potential of creating a super format, selling around the world. So the best brains work on this, but they don't come along very often at all. They come along very rarely. Around, leaving that aside, I'm talking about the great big juggernauts, there's lots of entertainment opportunities and new things in entertainment going on all the time, and really good new entertainment programs, some revived ones as well. You know, that's the normal stuff of everyday life.
Well, there's an awful lot of questions on Rising Star, so before we leave entertainment, just a quick one. Can we expect a presenter stroke judge announcement soon for Rising Star?
I don't know. I haven't got a particular date on that. No, I think it'll be a little way off, to be honest.
Have you got someone in mind?
Oh, we're talking about it, but we're not. It's not imminent.
Miranda. Anyway, let's move on. Another very important genre, more perhaps even than entertainment, drama. I'm not even going to ask this question, but I know you wouldn't want to answer it anyway. But who would be stars you if you were our hero in it? Who would play you? But you're here hero in your own drama on ITV, so let's just look straight away at the clip that you've chosen to play for drama. Now, funnily enough, that was the clip that you chose as your riskiest clip.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Well, I absolutely love that drama, by the way, and I love that clip. And I remember when I first saw that sequence, I kind of jumped out of my seat when he nearly got hit by the train. Why? Because that writer had never written anything for television at all. So I wanted to play to something that people will often say, well, when do you take risks on new talent? He'd never written a thing, never written anything. And he's absolutely brilliant. And also, it's not at all an obvious piece in some ways. I remember Steve November, our director of drama, coming to me when he was seeing first cuts of it and said, look, we like it, but we're not really sure it's ITV drama. You know, as you can see from that, the camera
so
works
dark,
kind of on the
edgy,
wobbly side. It's very edgy. It's very uncompromising. It's brilliantly edited. I think the editor should, you know, get an award for that clip alone. And so, again, I didn't want to, you say, what's your riskiest thing? I didn't want to reach for something around the fringes of the schedule. It's straight down the middle, 9 o'clock drama, but it wasn't in any way saying, well, we know you'll deliver because you've written half a dozen previous things. He'd never written anything for television.
Well, we're going to look at your 2015 drama slate later on. But again, on drama, what are you looking for?
Well, drama, again, obviously drama on ITV is hugely varied. So the answer is a bit of everything. Contemporary, period, crime drama. Audiences love crime
more
drama.
Period. We
don't.
Period?
Well, when you say more period, you would never put up the shutters and say we don't want any more period drama. But at any one time, while planning your slate, you kind of look at a balance and think, well, we want plenty of contemporary drama as well. We've had some very successful period drama, Downton Abbey, Mrs. Selfridge, things like that. One of the things I liked about Prey is that it's a terribly urban contemporary piece. If we, you know, if at any moment in time in commissioning you said, let's charge exclusively down this road, you would regret it a year or two later. Mm. So you're moving in all directions at any one time.
But interestingly, though, with Prey, and you said yourself it is unusual for ITV, that kind of whole look of it, is that the kind of, it's not noir or anything, but it's the kind of area where that people have found so popular, for example, with Scandi drama and so forth, that actually it's a bit of a darker take, because actually the audience generally looks like it likes that.
I think absolutely, and I think you can go darker in mainstream drama. A lot of mainstream drama is really quite dark. I don't think you want to restrict yourselves with too many rules. You're looking most and foremost. One of the in a sense purities of drama commissioning is that it's nearly all script based. So you have a script, and you should just commission what you believe to be the best scripts. Either if a script is good enough, an audience will follow you anywhere. And I think it's increasingly about writers. So in the case of Prey, Chris Lunt, who, as I said, who'd never written for television before, and at the moment his name is less well known than, say, Julian Fellowes or Chris Chibnall, but before Broadchurch, Chris Chibnall's name was less well known. The apart from the fact that where they work with the very best production companies, which is Red in the case of Prey, or Carnival, Kudos in the case of Broadchurch. You're looking for, this sounds an awful kind of platitude when I say it, I've said it before, you're sort of saying to writers, ITV is a stage, and it's a big stage, it's the Olivier, it's not the Cottesloes, if you've got the ambition, then, would you like to write a drama for this stage? It can be about anything you like. That's not the issue. You can make drama about anything as long as it's brilliant drama.
I just want to bring the audience in on drama, just specifically. If there's any drama questions before I move on, I'd just like to hear them just now. Has anyone got anything just to contribute on drama? Because there's tons to get through here, so I really would like to hear from you on drama just now. Okay, let's move on now. Big story ITV last year was the overhaul of the breakfast offering. How's that going?
Well, we started Good Morning Britain 2 or 3 months ago now, and obviously it's played through the summer months, which is slightly... school holidays when the audience levels across breakfast television aren't as great. We're right behind the show. I think it's fresh. I think it's different. We've tried to break the mould with Good Morning Britain. I think it's got a really good team on screen, a great team working behind the scenes. That hasn't at this moment, shown itself in a kind of identifiable jump in the audience. But we would expect audience viewing at breakfast to move quite slowly. Funny enough, going back again, when I was at the BBC,
But does it need to get 15% of the breakfast audience? Well, again,
but I don't want to say it's got to get such and such a percentage.
But surely it's got to get a reasonable amount of viewers before you're going to...
Yeah, we would love it to... We would love it to be, a popular offering, and the most popular offering can be at breakfast.
But it's not.
I'm not expecting a sudden overnight transformation in the ratings. It'd be coming into the autumn as the kind of kids back at school, audience levels rise, and it'd be nice to see the audience level rise, and I dare say we will. I think, in a way, you can't control that. What you can control, what you can do, is say, what are we doing with the show? What is different and more modern about this show? And I think anybody who's watched ITV breakfast shows over the years will say Good Morning Britain is different, it is fresh, it is modern, it's got a very good team on it, so it has our confidence and our support.
Is it true, stories in the press, that Susanna Reid was being told by bosses at ITV to soften?
I don't know what you're going to say, but the answer is going to be no, whatever you're going to say. So, what did we say to her?
The answer is going to be no anyway.
Well... We don't. I could tell the answer.
I think it's really interesting.
When Susanna Reid was being told by bosses, because we're not normally in the process of in the business of telling our talent.
Well, I just wondered if that's the case.
Sorry, I've been rather rude.
There were reports that Susanna Reid was being told to soften her image on breakfast. I mean, just categorically, please tell me that's not true.
Absolutely not at all. Of course not.
No. Right. Good. Nailed that one then. That was an exciting nail. Anyway. I'm going to make you a quote here. We have a very strong editorial team who are committed to making this show as good as it can be, but it's not going to happen overnight. You also said, if you're a regular viewer, you'll see something different. It's a good show. You were talking about Daybreak, and 18 months later, you canned it.
Well, I would say with Daybreak that Daybreak, you know, there were various different phases of Daybreak because it had an initial presenting team, then a second one, then a third one, and various different editors. We never quite got Daybreak right. I think we would have been open to criticism if too soon and too early we'd said, well, let's bring that to an end and move on to something else. And we would be equally open to criticism if we'd gone on too long, because eventually you've got to say, let's try something else at the other end. Did we get that about right? I don't know. You can only kind of address the issue as you see it at the moment. And when we got to the point of thinking, actually, the right thing to do is to start something new, it felt like the right moment. We felt like we'd given Daybreak a really good chance to work, and I'll be honest, it didn't quite work.
No, but Good Morning Britain is ITV Studios. That's their production.
So is Daybreak.
Which means, though, that that currently produces nearly 60% of the ITV output. I mean, should people outside be worried about being frozen out if you're continuing to try and build ITV IP?
No, not at all. ITV Studios do make quite a lot of our output, and of course they make Coronation Street, they make Emmerdale. When you add together those sorts of things and daytime shows like This Morning and Good Morning Britain, Jeremy Kyle, of course that, you know, that adds up to a big percentage. If you look at the commissioning budget of ITV, you come to a much, much lower percentage of that, and much, much higher percentage for indies, percentage that I honestly believe there is opportunity on the ITV schedule in all the major genres for all and everyone. So, and also, by the way, from the biggest indies and the super indies who we obviously work with, the smallest indies. We just commissioned a comedy called The Delivery Man from an indie run by Victoria Park called Monica. That's about as small and new an indie as you could possibly get. We've commissioned a series
from them. But ITV shows are trying to hoover up indies at the moment, aren't they?
Well, I don't know. I don't sit here to speak for ITV Studios because that's the other side, that's Kevin Ligo's side of the business and the other side of the business. But absolutely true that ITV Studios have been acquiring indies on both sides of the Atlantic, rather more in America than in the UK. But some really important and very brilliant indies in the UK, like The Garden and Big Talk. Well, you know, sitting where me and the commissioning team do an ITV commissioning, we're hardly going to mind if The Garden and Big Talk become part of our sort of extended family, because they're great indies and so television.
But the danger is that freezes out others.
Well, no, if you take The Garden as an example, who I would guess make more for Channel 4 than they do for us, but I'm really glad to say they make some really good things for us, but they come to us to sell programmes exactly like other factual indies.
Well, there's a lot of factual producers in here now, and let's talk about factual, because you took Richard Klein, who's here in the front row, from BBC Four last year, and you said in that session last year, when it was Meet the Controller, that was your ninth Meet the Controller session, you wanted to take ITV out of its comfort zone. What has Richard Klein delivered to take ITV out of its comfort zone?
Richard's made a big difference to the kind of tone of factual commissioning, the output of factual commissioning. Quite a lot of it's still in the pipeline, not all of it you've seen on air. But we played quite a lot out in this summer that's, I think, a more entertaining side of commissioning, very accessible entertainment side of commissioning. I feel slightly embarrassed to sit about 10 feet from Richard and summarise, which he would do much better himself, tone that he brings to ITV commissioning. But obviously that's an evolving thing, and it ought to be, because in all genres you want to, in a sense, be continually moving and moving forward and saying, let's do things we wouldn't have otherwise
but
done.
But I'm not going to say there's a ceiling for an audience for factual, but even, you know, factual programmes where you would think would be hugely popular, for example, Kids with Cameras, for example, pulls in 1.3 million. Diary of a Children's Hospital pulled in 1.3 million. That's not a big enough audience for you for factual, isn't it?
Well, I think you need to kind of look across the piece. You could equally go to Monday nights for the last 6 weeks and say Long Lost Family is just one of our absolute strongest factual brands and has been for about the last 4 years and is still still growing and obviously you would like with in a sense when you're in mainstream television. If you believe that the sort of the sweet spot is something that one, gets a big audience, two, you really believe in it, believe is a good program, and you know, maybe related to that is well-received, gets reviews, awards, and so on. That's a sweet spot. You won't get that with every commission. I would rather be proud of our output than think that we were attracting big audiences by sort of peddling stuff that we weren't really proud of. So Kids with Cameras, Diary of a Children's Hospital, by the way, it's the same program.
Your advertisers might not be so happy, you know.
Well, I take that point, and we're in commercial television. Commercial television, you know, without a doubt, in the mainstream, wants to get larger audiences. But I would make this point to advertisers, and I do make this point to advertisers. You mustn't think narrowly and purely about the ratings of every program and every slot. You need to look in the broader sense at the quality of the brand offering of ITV and what it consists of and what it stands for. So to put a bit of flesh on that, in the last few years, I've started various different things in the ITV schedule in the genres that were once sustained mainly by quotas from Ofcom. I'll get to the point in a minute. So examples, exposure, our investigative current affairs, Strand, Perspectives on Arts, Tom Bradby's The Agenda, Raggy Omar now in On Assignment, which is a kind of foreign correspondent show. None of those are likely to really rate, if you want to be honest, if you want me to be honest. But what do they say about ITV's output? They say it's about quality and range and depth, rather than, if you like, simply and narrowly going for a 5 or 6 million audience in every slot and every night. So okay. I think that there's a commercial argument that sustains that.
That you obviously the Holy Grail for Factual was a returning series.
Yes, yes, yes. So we have things in the pipeline. We Bring Back Borstal is a new show, a new flavour that we're quite excited about for early next year. That is a format is slightly in the tradition of Bad Lads Army and that sort of thing. That would be lovely if it came back, but. But, you know, we all know, and not just ITV, we all know that the returnable factual or fact and format are elusive and hard things to find. Again, I've been through this many times before, but I quickly stated, where you see them on BBC One, they tend to have come from BBC Two, most recently The Bake Off, when I was there, Who Do You Think You Are, The Apprentice. We don't have the same relationship with our digital channels. We don't have the same budgets for our digital channels that the BBC has for BBC Two. So you're not able to incubate a show like that and take it fully formed to BBC One. They've got to hit the ground running a bit more with ITV. That's a bit tougher, but it's still our job and we'll continue to do it.
Let's move on to comedy now, and time for a clip. And this is the one you felt was your best What I Was Thinking moment of the last 12 months. So why was that clip? What was I thinking?
Well, I must admit, I behaved in quite, an uncharacteristic way here, because the writers, Lawrence Marks and Maurice Grant, came to see us and said that they wanted to revive Birds of a Feather, and I don't think there's any secret about this, I think they've said this, but the BBC had said, well, we might do that, we'll offer a Christmas special. And they said to me, if you offer a series, we'll do it with you. And, you know, we normally think quite hard about commission decisions, and I think we're quite collegiate about it, discuss it ourselves and think. But on this occasion, we didn't really do that at all. We literally left the room. This is me and Elaine Bedell and my family Moore, who was our comedy commissioner at the time, and looked at each other for about 2 minutes and said, should we just say yes? And then we went back and said yes. And, you know, Lo and Mo, as they're called, have said this in interviews, said this was the fastest commission decision they'd ever heard. And so the moment to think, what the hell have we done, came rather later, because I was really thinking, well, it had been a BBC sitcom. Would people in any way applaud us for bringing back a BBC sitcom 15 years later? So we were then quite nervous and thought, oh my God, what have we done? And then it came out right at the beginning of the year, and went out on a Thursday night at 8:30, and we woke up the next day, got nearly 9 million viewers. And we thought, we've done the right thing.
A tremendous achievement. But does that mean you're going to be scoring through lots of old other 80s programmes?
Yeah, we tried to do it. We then immediately did that, of course.
The Liverbirds.
We've got a list of them. I tell you what the unique thing is, although, quite honestly, this is the benefit of hindsight, because we didn't really think this through at the time. What's unique about it, the whole cast of that came back. So you get offered revivals of sitcoms in the 80s or whatever, but nearly always you can't get the original cast. But, you know, they were all you know, available. They've been doing it live on the road and with great success. And of course, picking up where the birds were 15 years later, it seemed an entirely logical thing to do. But I can't say that deep, meaningful thought went into it. It was just one of those moments when somebody offers you something off the back of a lorry, as it were, and you say, "All right, we'll have it." And we did then think, "What have we done?" But audiences loved it, and I don't think the fact that it was on the BBC previously mattered in the least, actually.
Comedy is so tough to get right. I mean, we've talked about taking risks. We don't need to talk about that so much anymore, but really just in terms of nurturing comedy. I mean, what are you...
You're absolutely right. And in the, you know, in mainstream channels, not very much comedy easily, new comedy easily lands on mainstream channels with big audiences. I mean, we've had... Benidorm has done a wonderful job for us for the last 6 or 7 years and continues to grow in its appeal. And, we absolutely love it. We have the return of Vicious next year, which, you know, I think I could reasonably say was a risk-taking sitcom by any standards. We have a lot of comedy, but I know we're not here to talk about ITV2 on ITV2, which has become quite a home of comedy. So I think if I look across ITV, I think there's a lot going on in comedy. I am, everybody knows, ran a comedy company for many years, a comedy person by background, so I wouldn't want not to feel that we were addressing the important issue of what's the role for comedy in ITV. But I'm not pretending it's the easiest genre, or has been, or will be the easiest genre.
In as much as these decisions are made about how you skew channels, much has been talked about losing club football. So, barring ITV4, all your channels skew heavily female, so it must have been a real blow to lose club football.
Well, the commission genres will tend to have more of a female skew, and male audiences, we all know they're more elusive and hard to get. I think you could quite easily say, one, that we had almost a sort of surplus of live football. We were, we had the Champions League, the Europa League, the FA Cup, all England qualifiers, half of the Euros and half of the World Cup. I'm not sure that any terrestrial channel had ever had such a sort of rich amount of live football as that. So we could afford to lose some of it without, we still got a lot of live football. But, there's no getting away from the fact the price... sports rights is a very pure market. It's a market, controlled by people who control sports rights, and they follow the money. The entrance of BT into the market, the kind of arms race between BT and Sky, what are BT paying for a Champions League match? Well, it's between £6 and £7 million a match. Well, we had a Champions League match earlier in the week, an Arsenal match against a Turkish club, and I think it got just over 3 million viewers. We won't get that on BT. Mm. So they're buying those viewers very, very expensively indeed. So there comes a time when we have to think, well, it's not a wise use of our budget to chase that.
Do you want to have more male-skewed programmes? Is that an area,
yes,
for example,
yes,
factual?
We would like to have more male-skewed.
What is a male-skewed programme?
Well, that's a very good question, isn't it?
And so you're the controller.
The danger is you end up describing Top Gear in sort of 10 different ways. And the last thing, in a sense, you would want to do, and actually the worst thing for ITV to do, is to look as if it's copied somebody else's programme. And I think that's a bad habit from the old days of ITV.
Yeah,
and I've tried to
and
get away from
that.
Well, fair enough.
But so what do you do, though, if it's not a gadget show, if it's not Top Gear? I mean, no, I'm not sure what a male programme is.
There are, without a doubt, there are programmes with a stronger male appeal than others. But I don't want to sit here saying, please bring us Top Gear or The Gadget Show. I think it's a very fair point to say that if within our schedule there were more programmes that had a stronger male appeal, now that we're going to have rather less football, that would be a good thing. Again, this shouldn't be a handbrake turn. I don't want to suddenly see some massive lurch towards...
Sheds.
Indeed. Indeed. Shed of the Year.
Shed of the Year. That would get lots
shed
of men.
The year. I want to be in it.
Beard of the Year.
I think it's to producers out here, I would say, I think this is an interesting challenge. I haven't got the answer, Kirsty. I don't know.
But please
be in a dialogue with us about ideas that you feel may have a stronger male appeal, because somewhere out there may be an idea that will do that for us. We'll get to more male audiences. We get male audiences, of course, on ITV4, which has still got a very, very rich supply of sport, but that doesn't mean we don't want them on the main channel.
Now, we're coming on to the future. Before we're going to take questions from the audience now, it's time for the last clip, and it's what you decided was the upcoming show you are most excited about. So, why is this the programme about which you're most excited?
Well, it's one of our dramas this autumn. We've got a number of dramas this autumn. We're excited about them all, but I'm really excited about Grantchester. When it was cast, this is a bit of an omission, this, and the key cast were, sort of run past me, and they said, we want to cast James Norton, and I didn't know much about him. I said, well, you're fine, if you think he's good, let's cast James Norton. I hadn't watched, at that time, Happy Valley, which I subsequently watched, was a BBC One show that I thought was brilliant, and I hadn't connected the fact that he was the psychopathic nutter in Happy Valley, and here he's playing this 1950s vicar in Grantchester. And so when I realised the link, I was so delighted about it because he's brilliant and he's an incredibly convincing vicar. It's based on books written by James Runcie, who's the son of an archbishop. It's produced by Diedrich Senter, who's the son of a bishop, I think, and it's about a vicar. And that's quite unlikely for ITV. But it's got Robson Green in it, who hasn't been in a drama on ITV for a while, and I think our audiences love him. So he's a rather familiar element. James Norton's a new element there. Really delightful films. I don't want to put the curse on it by saying I think it'll be a hit, but it's just one we're very excited about this autumn.
I'm coming out to the audience now. Before I do, the one issue that's been discussed in other sessions as well, and has also been more publicly discussed by the BBC, is the whole issue of diversity. Mm-hmm. And there's been no kind of public commitment. So tell me, what's your gut feeling about that on ITV?
What do you mean there's been no public
commitment? What do you think about the committing to a certain amount of production and talent that represent diversity?
I think that there is a consensus from all broadcasters that there's a real job to be done here and a real difference to be made. I don't think there's anything that divides us on that front at all. I think where we go about it slightly differently is how we believe we'll get there. What we're working on and already discussing with our suppliers is what I'm calling, in a slightly broader sense, a social partnership that's part of what commissioning's about. So it's not just about, is this drama exciting? Is this entertainment program entertaining? It's not just about, what's the budget? What are the terms of trade? It's what's the social side of this defined in various ways? Is it inclusive on screen? Does it have diversity on screen? What's the CSR element of it? And so on. And I'm particularly keen that we do this with our suppliers. I think this is a partnership. I'm slightly more reluctant to impose upon producers and suppliers specific targets, and I'm not particularly keen on inviting external regulation. I think television is a highly regulated industry, always has been. Generally speaking, regulation in recent years has been reduced in television. The quotas at Ofcom tell us how many programmes in this genre, that genre to make, and so I'm not sure that it's...
But you do think there's a job of work?
I think there's definitely a job of work to be done. I think that the current, if you like, campaign about this that Lenny Henry and others have spearheaded has done an extraordinary job, actually, in making this so front of mind, and that's why we're discussing that, why we discussed it yesterday. And I absolutely want ITV to be at the leading edge of this, without a shadow of a doubt.
Can we get the audience lights up? Because we've got 10 minutes for questions and we want to get as many in as possible. Right, who's first up? Who's first up? There must be a question for Peter Fincham somewhere out there. No questions for Peter Fincham in this controller session. There's a question, yes, right at the very back, there's a hand up. And any more up here for the next one? Fire away.
Daniel Tull, I run M&E for IBM Europe. Peter, obviously the UK market is quite competitive. When you're commissioning, it's quite competitive. Picking a hit is really hard. you know, ITV has been the bulwark, if you like, of commercial broadcasting in the UK for a long time. To what extent do you sort of think about the international appeal of a programme when you're commissioning?
Probably quite a lot less than you might think. I mean, I think that if you thought like that as a commissioner, I'd honestly think you'd come unstuck. You should think about the UK audience. If the producers who are making a programme want to, you know, see it as something of international appeal, then their best possible bet, a way of achieving that, is to have a big hit in the UK. So I would have a pretty single-minded focus on that. I mean, as I'm speaking, I'm trying to think of a good example, and I suppose the best example is Downton Abbey, because in the last 5 or 6 years, there has been no more successful ITV commission in terms of selling in different countries. It's in over 200 countries worldwide, and I absolutely assure you that in the development of that, the commissioning of that, not a moment's thought was given to its international appeal, and not by us, anyway.
More questions from the audience, please, but here's some on the app. What has happened to investigative journalism on ITV?
Well, investigative journalism is alive and well, and as I was saying earlier, until we started Exposure a couple of years ago, we, outside of the Tonight programme, we didn't have a current affairs strand devoted to investigative journalism. I can remember 2 years ago now, this was on the eve of when we broadcast the, you know, the documentary about Jimmy Savile. That was a big call, and in some ways, I suppose, quite a nervous moment. I think it would be, you know, without resorting to hyperbole, reasonable to say that that programme may have had more impact on society
Absolutely.
Than any current affairs programme for the last decade. So I'm not saying that alone is an answer to that question, but investigative current affairs is alive and kicking hard on ITV.
Can we get a question just in the front here? Yes.
And by the way, not because Ofcom asked us to do it, or there was any quota backing it up at all?
Yeah, Dan Korn from Discovery. You've got a brilliant tradition of drama storytelling on ITV, but much less so with documentary. What sort of documentaries do you want to see on the network? And I've got another question, which is on a completely different point. Do any of the points that David Abraham made about consolidation in the industry concern you?
Well, as you said, two totally different points. Documentaries, well, we absolutely have a traditional documentary. We had, not that this is really an answer to your question, we had two of the three nominations for the best single documentary at BAFTA this year. So you know, there are single documentaries on ITV that will continue to be, and in recent years, I think we've done some brilliant ones. Your second point about consolidation, I don't think we should go all Little England about this, or Little Britain about this, I should say. The sector changes, it mutates. It's like consolidation within the indie sector, which I've always felt that as indies consolidates into super indies, there is also an equal pressure to spawn new indies, and new indies start all the time. I'm sure there's plenty of people in this room who are part of new or recently formed indies, and I think there's huge opportunities for them as well. You could even argue that there's in some ways a shortage of properly independently owned small and medium indies because they've all been gobbled up by big indies. I think that's the operation of a market, and you shouldn't generally, well, that's part of that market. Yeah. I don't think you should generally either intervene in that market too much or resist its forces too greatly.
Another question from the audience? Yes, keep your hand up, please, and we'll get the microphone to you.
Yes, Toby Seifert from Enders Analysis.
Toby.
Sorry, Peter, I had to ask you one eventually. The question before was simply about whether you think of the international opportunities when you're commissioning. But then, of course, there's been very interesting expansion into other countries, as in America, being now leading independent. To what extent do you see opportunities now coming back to this country from abroad?
In what do you mean? In what way?
In terms of, you know, you're developing ITVB is coming on.
Yeah.
You've got ITV2 and things. Do you see it's not just a question of doing things here, which suddenly do well abroad,
yes.
But there's also the question of the return.
I think you will see traffic between the UK and the US. I mean, one of ITV-owned companies, Gurney, who make Duck Dynasty in America, that plays on ITV4. And I'm sure you'll see more of that, but I think that primarily the strategy of acquiring companies in America is to build up a presence in America, and as I say, that isn't really my side of the business, but you know, a lot of activity's gone on in that way, and it would be surprising if you didn't see some, you know, cross traffic. I mean, you know, these are the two of the most important markets in the world, the UK and US, possibly the two most important. So it's really good that ITV's got a significant kind of beachhead in America.
A question here on the app. You were only there for a shortish time, but what can the BBC learn from the way ITV is run?
I have no idea.
You mean it can't learn anything?
I so don't want to sit here and tell the BBC how to run their business. And, okay. I never have, and I wish them...
Okay, wish them well, I'm afraid the person who asked that is not going to get any answer. One final question up there. Someone, I know that person.
Oh, it's your husband.
And then we're going to get kicked out. I've just been told, so we'll have to finish.
Does he always have to put his hand up to get your attention?
All the time. Following on the question about consolidation, with Liberty taking a stake in ITV, are you concerned about takeover bid and being owned by Americans? And a second, maybe a slightly more domestic question, given the BBC on Monday night will play their referendum debate across the UK, do you think ITV or some part of the family should have taken the STV debate, given the amount of controversy it caused?
Well, to the first one about the Liberty, it's sort of above my pay grade. I mean, that's a corporate issue. It is, honestly.
Can be nobody above your pay grade.
And so I just sit toiling away on the 21st floor commissioning programmes. I've no idea. That's not my area. To the second one, Alan, well, as you think you know, we're going to, with the second debate, that's an STV debate, because for anybody who doesn't know, this question was from Alan Clements from STV. We're gonna play it on itvnews.com. We're gonna play it also on the main channel at 10:35. I mean, obviously, you know, the principle that this debate, you can see in the rest of Great Britain and in England and Wales is a good principle. And indeed, you know, the first debate was available to see in that way on STV Player, but we extend that by using ITV.com.
But had you wished it was on a mainstream channel?
Sorry?
Would you wish you'd played it throughout the UK?
Well, you know, again, just come back to what we were talking about with the difference between our channel family and others' channel family. The BBC have got, is it one or two debates between Alex Salmond and Alistair Darling? And they're playing it on BBC Two.
Yeah.
And we don't have an equivalent to BBC Two. So I don't think that it's you know, playing it at 8 o'clock from between 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock on ITV's main channel is, you know, I don't think that's right for us. But I'm really happy that we're playing it at 10:35. It will be available on both STV Player and ITVnews.com.
We are going to get kicked out.
And I hope that that's the right, you know, and I think that you guys at STV agree that that's a good extension of its availability.
Quickly, just in a nutshell, you're quickly 2014 and ITV. What's fabulous about it?
What's fabulous about it is our forthcoming autumn season that we're really, really excited about.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, broadcast sponsor this session. Thank you very much, and thank you very much, everybody.